Good morning. My name is Tennille Davis, and I just wanted to speak a moment and give you a quick snapshot on how the Met Church has influenced my life and my family. In 2005, I found the Met Church whenever it was over there off of 1709. I had just gone through a divorce. I had a brand new baby girl, and I was broken. I was someone I was not proud to be, and I was someone that I knew I could be better. So I found the Met, and I would sneak in the back, sit in the very back row. I wouldn't make eye contact with anyone. I wouldn't talk to anyone. And I'd leave as soon as it was over. And I sat in that seat and I just kind of let the words that Pastor Bill was preaching sink in. And what I had broken was starting to change. And I was becoming someone better. So that was 2005. 2006, early, I dedicated my baby girl, Carson, and dedicated her to raise her in a Christian home, to set those values and those standards. Then in late 2006, I married my husband, Todd. 2007, we had my son, Waylon. 2011, my baby girl was saved and baptized at the sweet age of 7. And then in 2013, my little man, he was 5 and a half at the time, he really wanted to be saved and baptized. So Pastor Scott gives this class where you go as a family and he just talks about all the foundations of it and what it really means to see if your kid really gets it. And at 5, my little man got it. His heart was there. So I was sitting through that class and I looked at my husband and I said, you know what, honey, I think I need to be baptized again too. And he's like, okay. See, I was baptized as a teenager, but I didn't really have that memory. I didn't really recall that moment. So I wanted to create a new memory. And I thought, what better way to do it than with my son? So it was Mother's Day weekend, 2013, and we were celebrating at my sister's house, and my mom was there, and I was telling my mom about what was coming up at the end of the month. And my mom goes, you know what? I need to do that too. And so she got excited. And so she went and sat next to my dad and said, hey, honey, I'm gonna go get baptized with the kids at the end of the month. Do you want to also? And my dad said, you know what? I need to also. So the four of us in May of 2013, as a family, were baptized. Look at that. Look at those faces, guys. Look at that little man, that 5-year-old that had faith. And then look at my mama. Look at that. And Rob was such a huge part of this for us. So that was May of 2013. This is where it gets sensitive, so give me a second. 3 short months later, in August, my mom passed away. And it was pretty quick and pretty sudden. But because of the Met Church, my family and I have faith in knowing we are gonna see my mom again one day. So I just wanted to take a second and just say thank you, Pastor Bill. Thank you for jumping when God told you it was time to start a new church. Thank you for following him. And thank you, Miss Cindy, and thank you, Shannon and Billy. Thank you for the sacrifices that I know your family took in the beginning. Thank you for not giving up. Thank you for trusting. And I just wanted to say thank you, Met Church. I love my church. I love my church family, and I appreciate each and every one of you that has loved on me and my family, especially in the rough times. But I am so grateful to celebrate our 20 years here, and I look forward to what's coming. So I just wanted to say thank you. I'm just one life that has been influenced by the Met Church.
God says, draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. I don't know where you are this morning. You may have a story like Tennille where your life has been transformed by God. Or you may be in a different place where you're here and you're searching and you're looking for answers. You're looking for an opportunity for God to speak to you, to show himself to you. So what better opportunity as we continue to worship for you to just get alone with God today and just ask God to show himself to you, to draw near to him, ask him to draw near to you and speak to you and to show his presence. So we want to invite you to continue and worship with us today. I want to be close to you. I want My life surrendered, my heart abandoned for more of you. Yeah, my soul devotion.
Thank you. It's hard to believe I was 17 there. Isn't that amazing? Wow, isn't that incredible? Glad I had a long shot there of it and all that. It's just been an exciting weekend, a lot of fun for us to stop long enough. As Romans 13 says, you give credit to whom credit is due, you pay tribute to whom tribute is due. And certainly this ministry has been all about Christ and what he has planted in our hearts to do, and the journey that we've been on and the people that have been impacted by it. And it's just been a wonderful thing to see. It has been an amazing thing to see all of the lives that have been touched and transformed through the work of the Holy Spirit in the life of this church. I believe every church is a unique expression of who Christ is. The church is the body of Christ. We are his body here on this earth, and we're unique in how we do things. We're unique in how we approach things, and we certainly should be. Anytime you try to duplicate or replicate what God has already done, it's almost an insult to the Creator, because he doesn't make duplicates, he makes originals. And this body of Christ called the Met Church is certainly a unique expression of who he is. And it's just been a joy to be a part of it. And it really came out of a sense of burnout in my life and in Cindy's life. I grew up in a very traditional church. My dad was my pastor, and I actually went on staff with my dad when I was still in high school. So ministry has been just about the only profession I've ever pursued. And I served for 10 years under my dad's leadership. And when he retired, the church called me to succeed him. So I then was pastoring the church that I had grown up in. And at 26 years of age, I was a pastor of one of the more historic Baptist churches in the country, a pretty incredible history. And so for 12 more years, I continued on as the senior pastor there. And so for 22 years, I had a ministry with my home church. And yet God was stirring something in my heart and in Cindy's heart to do something unique, to do something different, to kind of move out of the well-worn path and out of the wake of the boat that we had followed for all those years, to do something very, very incredible. And he birthed that idea through a time of burnout in my life. I was sitting in my office, and I remember looking out of the window, and I remember thinking, I have hit every rock on this hill trying to get a spark, and I just can't seem to get anything to work. We had a train track that ran by the church, and I remember I was so depressed. I thought, I'm like that train. Anything that goes in this building, I either have to pull it or push it. I'm like that engine. And I just got to the point where I was just burned out. I was just staring out in space. And I remember hearing a pastor friend of mine talk about a burnout, and he talked about sins of escapism. And he said, the problem when you hit burnout is you will gravitate, you'll migrate into sins of escapism. And that hadn't happened to me, but I realized I was vulnerable for that to happen to me. And I knew I needed to address how I was feeling. And so I talked with Cindy, and I called one of my closest friends who we had helped start his church in Grand Junction years ago, Fellowship Church there. And Dan and Anna invited us up, and we stayed in a little condo in the mountains at a little resort called Powderhorn. And it was in that resort for a few days. Cindy and I were just really trying to find out why it is I was feeling the way I was feeling, and either praying that God would reignite a passion in me for the church that I was in, or he would send me in a new direction, because I knew I couldn't stay the way I was. And it was in that little time of our prayer and time together that God birthed this idea of just doing a different church. Doing something very unique and contemporary, very contrasting the church that I had been in. And so we got excited about that. And I shared that with Dan and Anna. I said, hey, I think I know what God wants us to do. It was reigniting passion within me. We're going to start a new church. And at the time, we wanted it to be a part of my home church. I thought it'll be kind of like a satellite. It'll be a mission church, but it'll still be a part of the, so I'll kind of do both churches. I'll go over and do the early service and go to South Lake and do that service and then go back and do the late service. And so that was how we set out. And that's actually what we did the first 6 months. You ever been to the rodeo and see a trick rider riding on the back of two horses? You ever watch that? You ever see a guy and he's riding along there, and it's entertaining, isn't it? And it's exciting as long as those two horses are running together. But the problem happens when your horses start pulling apart. It's time to make a decision. And my horses started pulling apart. There was a desire within the core of people we had in South Lake to have my full focus there, and the feeling that until that happened, the church couldn't reach potential. And then there was a desire in the folks at the home church to have me back so my full attention would be there. And so I realized the ball was in our court. We needed to make another huge decision. And so Cindy and I committed to praying about it, and we felt like God was leading us to leave the old church and to go full-time at this church. And so we did. And it was an amazing, scary, exciting adventure. One of the things that was driving this is Cindy and I wanted our kids. We wanted our kids. We wanted Shannon and Billy to see God do something in and through our life that was very unique. In ministry, a lot of times we kind of build on the one who has been there before us, and we don't have an opportunity as a ministry kid to always see God do something fresh and unique through the parents, through our parents' ministry. I grew up, my dad's church was a very vibrant and exciting church, and I have many great memories of seeing how God used my mom and dad in tremendous ways to affect the lives of so many people. And I wanted our kids to have that experience. I wanted my kids to have that memory. And so one of the things we prayed about was that God would be able to put us in a place at the Met Church to where the kids could see God do something unique. So we thought, what will we call this church? So we started researching it, you know, and you had all these generic names like branch and tree and stone and all the, and then you had the churches that were named after something God did, living water, new life, all these things. So we said, well, do we want to call it after something God has done, or do we go generic and, you know, Bushy Creek, you know, Fork of the Road? One of the guys said, hey, be like Prince, just don't call it anything, just have a symbol. We're too cool for a name. We're the church, you know, anyway. So we got to talking about the area that we felt God was calling us to start this church in, because back then, there really weren't that many churches like this 20 years ago out in this area. Ed was going over at Fellowship, and he had that thing off and going, and other than what Ed was doing, there really wasn't a lot of churches that were like this 20 years ago. So we felt like this is where God wanted us to be. We wanted to plant it in the heart of this area, and so we planted it in South Lake. And so I talked to several business people, and we found out through some city planners that there was a name they were going to use that would capture the areas between the Alliance Airport and the DFW International Airport. They were going to call that whole region the Metroport Cities area. That's what it'll be known as. You have the mid-cities, you have Metroport Cities, and we said, that's it. We're on the ground floor, cutting edge. We're going to call it Metroport Cities Fellowship. That's it. We're there. 20 years later, I think us and the Humane Society and Meals on Wheels are the only ones that caught on to that name. But we're hanging in there. We're called. We branded this thing, and bless God, we're hanging on to that. Maybe it'll be called that one day, but right now, we have our own street. Did you see that? Metroport Way, right over there, about a block long. But anyway, So we held, and then we said, well, that's too much to say. People will never remember it. So we just tightened it up a little. We said, we'll just call it the Met Church, right? Friend of mine in Houston, he calls his church that. There's the, you know, the big museum up there. It's called the Met. So we just said, that'd be a catchy thing that people could remember. So that's how we got our name. And so what was interesting about it is once we began to get traction in this young church, we began to realize that the validity of our ministry would be in the lives that God was touching, because when you're in a high school auditorium, it's hard to evaluate progress. Man, it would ebb and flow. I mean, we had a vision when we started. If you've ever been to Carroll High School in the auditorium, you know that thing seats 1,000. Talk about the vision. And I was thinking when we rolled in, I thought, well, okay, it seats 1,000. We'll go to two services pretty quick. God love that boy. There were a lot of weekends we looked like a BB in a shoebox. You know what I'm saying? I think we had more on the platform than we had out in the room, a lot of those services. We would look out there a lot of time just to see if anybody was coming. I remember Donnie and Max and Lynn, we'd back trucks up the driveway, and we kept all the stuff in our garage, and we'd load in, and we'd take it all up to the thing and set it up, and then we'd go home, pray, prepare, come back up and do the service. And I remember on one occasion we'd set the sound, we had everything ready to go, and boy, this big old storm cloud starts rolling in. I mean, it was foreboding. It looked rough. And Max walks out, and he looks at that thing, and he goes, there's not going to be anybody here. And Sharon said, Max Cannon, don't you speak like that. Don't you talk negative talk. He goes, I mean early, they're coming later. They're gonna be here after a while. One more story on Max, I have to tell you this. Our first Christmas at Carroll High School, we talked him into being Santa Claus, right? And so Max agreed to be Santa Claus, and so we mic'd him up. And if you know Max, to mic Max up isn't always a great thing to do unless you're on that mute button. And what we didn't realize is we had Max live in the house. And we had probably 300 or 400 people there on that Christmas. And Max kind of begrudgingly, you know, he was Santa Claus. And so I met him behind the stage out on the Carroll High School. We were about ready to start the service. A lot of people are out in the room. And we don't know, but his mic is hot. And so he walks up to me, and I look at him like this, and he looks at me like this, and I said, Santa Claus. He goes, yeah, yeah, yeah. Ho, ho, egg sucking ho. Wall to wall, baby. Carroll High School. That was a defining moment in the life of our church. That's called weeding out the religious spirit of your church. Anybody that stayed after that had no Phariseeism, no hypocrisy, no legalism whatsoever. We knew we had found our crowd right then. That was a defining moment. But it was just exciting to see how God was working in the life of the church. Our goal was twofold. We wanted to reach people who didn't know Jesus, number one. Number two, we wanted to reach people who knew Jesus but had moved away from him and were now coming back to him. So that was really our target audience. That's who we were going. That's what drove the way we presented the service. That's what drove everything we did. And in order to reach that group effectively, we had to have a core of people who, like me, came from traditional backgrounds, grounded in the Word, knew what we believed, but we were willing to give up some preferences in order to achieve that goal. And so little by little, we began to realize that the veracity, the authenticity of the ministry was being seen in the lives of the people who were changed. In fact, I want you to take a look at this. I thought about titling my message, Seeing What We Believed. And I thought, really, that's probably an appropriate way of looking at this. Because when you start a church, you have to see it before you see it, or you won't do it. So we saw the potential the church possessed. And now after 20 years, we're beginning to see those things come to fruition, the things that we believed. And there's a text I want to give you that I think is very appropriate for the weekend. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul started the church at Corinth, and he's writing back to this church. And notice what Paul is saying. He's saying, if you're looking for validation, if you're looking for affirmation for a ministry, look no farther than the people who have been impacted by that ministry. You yourselves, Paul said, are our letter written on our hearts. Known and read by everybody. You show that you are a letter from Christ, the result of our ministry, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. Paul said, this confidence is ours through Christ before God. He said, we're not competent in ourselves to claim anything for ourselves, but our confidence comes from God. Paul said, I realize every life that has been changed, every person who's been transformed, has been transformed by the power of God through the ministry he's called us to do. Now, this is the letter the founding pastor of the church was writing to that church. Now, let me step back one step and talk about when God put it in his heart to start this church. When you look back at Acts chapter 18, and we don't have time to read all the narrative, but I've called it your attention to it in our notes. In Acts chapter 18, there were four significant things that happened that enabled the Apostle Paul to start the church of Corinth. And ladies and gentlemen, these things are still relevant and applicable to the Met Church today. And by the way, they're relevant and applicable to any church today. Number one, in Acts chapter 18, Paul said, I found friends that helped us. In order to be productive, in order to be effective, Paul said, I found friends that helped us. Do you know everything God has created, he created to produce? Jesus walked by the fig tree. He cursed the fig tree because it was not producing. God made us to produce. In fact, he said, it isn't good for man to live alone. Man cannot be productive alone. So he gave him Eve. And after Adam and Eve came, you had production. What's the principle? You can't produce alone. No one can be productive in a vacuum. We need one another. The Bible says none of us lives to ourselves alone. None of us die to ourselves alone. What is a church? A church isn't bricks and mortar or sticks and stone. A church is people. In the Old Testament, God had a temple for his people, but in the New Testament, he has a people for his temple. He said, you are the temples of the Holy Spirit, 1 Corinthians 3. And so we realize, as the Apostle Paul talked about, that in order to be effective or successful in starting a church, you need some friends to help you. Paul talks about Aquila and Priscilla. Paul talked about Silas and Timothy. He talked about these people that caught the vision of what God was wanting to do and came alongside of them, and together they became productive. I think about the people that came into Cindy in my life, and many of them who are still there and are still helping us. You heard from Max and Sharon earlier. Lynn and Marsha was here at the first service. Rick and Terry. So many more people God sent into our lives at a strategic time. The CFO of our church, Donnie Beebe, was the first person we ever baptized here. First person. In fact, his wife, Jessie, is the founding pastor of our Met Kids ministry. It came out of her life. She was just in college, I guess, when we started the church, Jess. And so I'm saying, Cindy and I began to talk, like Max said, we talked at the cheerleader parents thing. You know, Max and I are in there, and I said, hey, I'm going to start this church. Oh, you're going to start a church? Yeah, well, hey, next thing you know, I mean, they're on board. Lynn and Marsha, I'm going to eat lunch with them one day after church, the old church, and I'm like, hey, we're going to start a church. Oh, you're going to start a church? We might be interested. We live out there in Southlake. Okay, and then all of a sudden, we realized that our kids had friends that they went to school with, and many of their friends weren't in anybody's church. So before long, when we started the church, we realized we had a church full of teenagers. We have a lot of teenagers out there. And all of a sudden, their parents got curious about, well, why are my kids wanting to go to that church at Carroll High School? And before you know it, the parents of those kids started coming. Oh, I know Bill from the football. So here we go. And all of a sudden, we're networking among the friends and the family members of our kids. And that began kind of the little genesis, the little group we started with, the core, out at Carroll High School. God sent people in our lives like Wayne Lee, who's here this morning, and his wife, Bernadine. I approached Wayne. We didn't have any place to office. Man, I had gone right out of the plane. Man, we were free falling, and I hoped I'd grab the parachute, not the backpack. And so I went to Wayne. Wayne said, you know what? You just office here with me. Wayne owned the building at Pearson in 1709. He allowed us to office there with him. And so Cindy and I, we rolled into there and had our staff meetings and looked at each other across the table. And so, what are we going to do today? Who are we going to try to get? You know? And then I found out later, do you know you can't go door to door in Southlake? You know that's against the law. They have an anti-solicitation deal. I didn't know that until I was about 8-10 blocks into that, knocking on doors and inviting people. I didn't know that was against the law. Thank God nobody called me in. But it was incredible because we started having people who came to the high school just to see what that thing was about. And I'm just saying that when I read that in Acts 18, that the thing that was significant about Paul starting the church at Corinth and the other churches that he started, and the thing that he did was he paid tribute to the friends that helped him. And I think on this weekend, it's so appropriate that I stop long enough to say those of you who've been a part of this since Carroll High School, and those God sent to us when we were in the grocery store, and those of you God sent to us since you've been here, God bless you and thank you for helping us. This ministry would not have happened. It would not be happening without the people God has sent here. Ministry happens because of the friends that help you. But here's the second thing Paul talks about. Not only friends that help you, but do you know there were some foes that opposed us? And I don't just mean personalities. I mean principles and powers and other unseen things that came again. Here's a truism of Scripture. You want a truism? Anything God is building, Satan will be blasting. When God is doing something, you can expect the devil to be doing something as well. People and places at the center of Holy Spirit activity will be people and places at the center of unholy spirit activity. And boy, we found that out to be true. In fact, I'll take a step back. Before we had our first service at Carroll High School, the Friday before the first service, we had spent over $6,000 on a direct mail piece that hit everybody in Southlake and Keller. And we were advertising this new church start. And Andy Wamsconce he was on the city council then, and he ended up being two-time mayor of Southlake. He and I have been friends since we were kids. So Andy had kind of helped us secure the high school. He's also our church's attorney. And so I get a call from my office in Fort Worth and said, Bill, we've got a phone call, And a guy in Southlake is threatening to get a court injunction against the church to prohibit us from having a service there, separation of church and state. What should we do about that? I said, beep, bleep, bleep, Andy, we have a problem here. And Andy has been such a great blessing in my life for many reasons, and this is among them. He goes, you know what, Bill? He goes, he cited a Supreme Court case where they had already ruled that if a school allows any other extracurricular group to meet within their facility, they cannot then prohibit a church from meeting in that same facility. And he said, so the high school has allowed scouting groups to meet in the school. They can't keep the church from meeting in the school. That's bogus. He said, beside that, it's Friday afternoon. He won't find a judge in Tarrant County that's going to give him an injunction. So with that, we went forward. But it was just a little taste of some of the headwinds that we would be facing in the days ahead. I mean, we had some pressures in our lives financially. We had pressures on the church financially. We had, just trying to get a team together to do worship was a challenge. Man, almost to the point, I was just like, can anybody out there sing? Come up and help a brother. If you can sing, we need some help. I mean, just about there. I was networking. I was calling in favors. It was just difficult because everybody wants to be a part of something once it's up and going. But when you are sitting there just struggling to get traction, nobody catches that, or not everybody catches that vision. So we had some headwinds. 3 years into our time at Carroll High School, I got a phone call from the school administration. They said, hey, can we talk to you? He said, you guys have been great tenants. We've loved having you here. You always leave the school in better shape than when you found it. We have no problem with you. However, we're going to set a precedent if we allow you to stay that we can't honor for other churches. So we're going to have to ask you to find another church, a building. And so, oh my word, have you priced real estate in South Lake? Have you done that? Have you looked around? And when you're a young church, you know, I mean, and we knew we'd need at least 20 to 25,000 square feet. I mean, we were looking at warehouses behind the car wash on Davis. I was driving around buildings 7 times, honking my horn. I mean, I was really, some of you people will get that. I was trying to find a building. We were looking for something we could afford, and it was a challenge. So I went in one day, and I talked to Wayne Lee. I said, Wayne, man, here's our deal. You know, we're going to have to get out of the high school, and I don't know. And he later talked about, you know, his thought was, you know, kind of good luck with all that, Bill. You know, I mean, wow. And so when I left his office, I mean, we were really, man, all of our guys, we were praying about it. We knew God wasn't done with this church, but we didn't know where we were going to go. I mean, we were facing this force, it seemed like, against us. We didn't know what we were going to do. And Wayne later shared this story, and I'll rehearse it with you briefly. He said, I hadn't been out of his office too long when he gets a call from a man from a company in Houston called Grocer Supply. And he said the man identified himself as being one who was representing a commercial property that they owned in Keller that they needed to sell, and the city of Keller had given them Wayne's name. And Wayne says, well, you must mean Ron Lee. Ron's a real estate agent in Keller that sells commercial buildings. He said, I don't sell commercial buildings. I'm a developer. I develop commercial property. So you got the wrong Lee. You need Ron Lee. I'm Wayne Lee. And the guy goes, no, the city was pretty definite. It's Wayne Lee. We got the right man. And Wayne said, I thought a minute. And then he said, all of a sudden, I remembered our talk just not long ago about the Met Church needing a building. So Wayne said, I said, well, wait a minute, let's talk about this. And after a series of conversations, Wayne came into my office to go, Bill, I think God may have given the Met Church a building. I said, really? He goes, yeah, I think we can get the Metro Food Store for $1 million. Now understand, we had about $2,000 in the bank just sitting in there collecting interest. We didn't know if we wanted to invest that or what we wanted to do yet. We were into 6 digits with a decimal 2 points over. So we were, you know, it might as well have been 10 million, right? I mean, I'm looking at Wayne, I just kind of smiled like, okay. So he goes, and Wayne's excited, Bill, this, you just don't know. I mean, that building in that area, I mean, this is a God thing. And so I'm trying to track with him. I mean, I'm supposed to be a spiritual leader, and I'm realizing, I got to get my faith amped up. And I said, well, you're right, Wayne, this is something we need, man. So I talked to the guys about it. I said, man, if we can get that somehow, something. And here was the deal. We all came to the conclusion, if it's of God, it's going to work. And if it's not, it's not. So we're going to pursue it. This whole church has been about pursuing God. And if it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. That's what Gamaliel, remember? It's what he said in defense of Paul. He said, if what they're doing is not of God, it'll fall apart. And if it is of God, you shouldn't fight against it unless you've found to be fighting against God. So we said, okay, what do we got to lose? The worst thing can happen to us is we'll fail. And I failed before. I could write a book on 100 things that won't work in the church. I know more things that won't work than will work. So I'm not afraid to fail. And I've ministered to happy people, motivated people. I've had people in my church that aren't born again, they're born against. So I know what that's like to face those kinds of headwinds too. And so we said, well, Wayne, would you be willing to come and share this with the church? And so Wayne graciously came over and presented it to the church. We were in Carroll High School, and he told the whole story. Now, the thing we failed to mention in his presentation was with our letter of intent that was going to be delivered on Monday, there had to also be a check for $20,000. Did I mention that $2,000 in our account just sitting there drawing interest? Well, Wayne failed to mention that. I failed to. None of us caught it. None of us caught it. Now, the core of us, after it was over, realized we didn't mention that we needed $20,000. And we were like, I thought, man, I felt like running out on 1709 going, come back, I forgot something. This is really important, you need to come back. You know, I thought, I can't do that. And they're probably leaving going, hey, free building, that's pretty good, yay God. You know, I mean, it's a little thing of the check we needed. And all of a sudden, I think it was Crystal Mason, she was processing the offering and she understood what had happened and she came running down there, waving this check in the air. And she held this check up and she said, look at this. It was a check from a man in South Lake by the name of Rusty Herod. And the check was made out for $20,000. I mean, I know. Is that crazy? I know this sounds like one of those stories where I say, put your Rolex right in that offering bag and God will do that for you. I mean, it just, so my cynical mind wanted to go there, right? I'm just saying those things don't happen to me all the time. That, in fact, the first time something of that magnitude had ever happened. So let me tell you where your pastor and my great faith went. I said, call him and make sure that's not a mistake. Not terrible. Should I have said that out loud? I hope I didn't just ruin my whole image here. But I just, and then I thought, well, maybe they meant to give it, but maybe it was to, you know, widowed grandmothers of orphans with athlete's feet. I mean, I don't know. Maybe it's designated to somewhere. So, and here's what they told her. They said, you know what? They said, we've been trying to find a church home, so we've been escrowing what we normally give to the church. We've been escrowing it. We just put it in escrow, waiting for God to send us to the right church. And they said, when we sat here and we caught the heart of this church and we heard what God was doing and we heard Wayne's presentation, he said, I just felt the Holy Spirit was telling us we need to give that money to this church. And he said, just use it wherever you need it. And I thought, we need it with a letter of intent going to Houston. And we sent it. And ladies and gentlemen, the next big headwind we faced was by the end of that same year, we needed about, if I remember right, about $150,000 to get the thing closed. And here we rolled out it once again, challenging 300 or 400 people to give. A couple of the business guys came in the office, and one of them, Lynn Wesley, Lynn says, Bill, God's hand is on this church. His hand is on your life. And some way or another, this is going to work out. And on that weekend, if I remember right, we had over $200,000 given. We secured that building, Metro Food Store. We remodeled it. We remodeled it twice before we sold it to Milestone. And it was just a miraculous, incredible journey with God. And can I tell you, every time we hit a headwind, it was God's affirmation, we're going in the right direction. Paul Harvey used to say, you know you're on the road to success when it's uphill all the way. Paul said it this way. He said, there's a great and effectual door open unto me, but there are many adversaries. Here's what I've learned from that verse, that the door of opportunity swings on the hinges of opposition. One of the ways you know you're not running into the devil, or with the devil rather, is when you're running into him. And oftentimes we've had these challenges and God has met them. So we found one, friends that helped us. We found two, foes that hindered us. Three, we found a father that honored us. When Paul was shut down from preaching in the synagogues, he said, that's okay. I'm not going to stop ministering. I'm going to keep ministering. And the Bible says Crispus and all the leaders of the synagogues came to faith in Christ. God opened a huge door to the apostle to minister through the opposition that he faced. What was happening? His heavenly Father was honoring his faithfulness. And can I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, God honors faithfulness. He honors perseverance. Charles Spurgeon used to say, by perseverance, the snail reached the ark. Think about that. Just keep on keeping on. Don't quit. And the fourth and final thing I would tell you is that we found a faith that would hold us. This thing has been about God, ladies and gentlemen. If this thing had been about Cindy and me, it had failed a long time ago, because as you know, I'm not that spiritual. It's been about him. It's been about the hand of God on the lives of people who just believed and wanted and desired to see God do something. I heard years ago, if you want something from God you've never had before, you better be willing to go somewhere with God you've never been before. And he's taken us on a journey like no other. I mean, I feel like one day when I die, I'm gonna slide sideways right in my grave. Just whoosh, ka-junk, it'd be there, right? It's been an adventure. It's been exciting. And I think that's what we're alive to do. Living is what we're alive to do. And this ministry has just been incredible. I had a deacon in my former church, and I'll close with this. He told me a story that I've related a couple of times here. He owned several trucks, big semi trucks, and he would lease those trucks out from time to time to haul corn up to Kansas during certain times of the year. And he told me on one occasion, he's driving this truck, pulling this load of corn in the middle of the night, and he hit black ice. And he said, when he hit the black ice, he said, I looked in my rearview mirror, and he said, I saw the trailer break loose and start coming around. And he said, boy, I knew if I did the wrong thing in the next few seconds, I could die or hurt someone. And he said, I knew if I tapped the brake, the truck would jackknife. So he said, what I did was I stayed focused on where I was going and I kept the pedal to the metal. And he said, what happened was that trailer pulled right back around me and I was able to get the truck safely to where I needed to go. I thought, that's a great illustration. And here I am 30 something years later using it again. I can tell you time after time when I've seen the trailer come around, when I thought, oh my word, what are we gonna do now? I've learned that if I'll stay focused on what God's called us to do and where he's trying to take us and keep the pedal to the metal, I found God will vindicate, he will protect, he will provide. We've had some big, big things that have happened where God has just really stretched us. One of the most recent things has just been with Cindy's health. Cindy's here this morning, and I get a lot of credit for stuff. Good Lord. Well, let me tell you something. Humanly speaking, this wouldn't have happened without her support. I appreciate all the prayers. We're praying for her healing and we're believing God, but she is the most optimistic person. She deals with it so much better than me. So much better than me. Well, and I've said all along, she's a lot more spiritual than me. That's probably one big reason. But I just wanted on this weekend, as I thank you and I thank all of you who've helped us and I thank you guys for being here, I just wanted to thank her and just say what a treasure and gift she is to my life. Thank you. Thank you, guys. If you'll be seated for just a minute, we'll go. I just wanted to pray over you. And again, I look around this room. I see some of you have been with us from Carroll High School and some of you who came on board when we were at Metro at the food store and some of you that have been here now since we've been in this location. And some of you that just decided to visit this weekend, you have no idea why you're here. Thank you for being here anyway. I don't believe in accidents. And I asked my family to come out here, and I just wanted, it's our last service of our anniversary. And so for those of you that don't know who we all are, this will give you a chance to kind of see who we all are. It's funny, when we started, Billy played drums for us, and it's crazy, he was 11 years old. Can you imagine that? When he started playing drums. And Shannon, as you saw, her and Ashley, and Amanda, they were in the worship team. They were teenagers, like 15 in the high school, singing up here. And I mean, it's just crazy. It was a family deal. Yeah, still is a family deal. And I think the kids would tell you now that we've seen God really do some good stuff. All right. It's the truth. That's Emma Townsley right there. Emma loves her papa, don't you, Emma? You love your papa. And there's Sam Townsley. Sam loves his papa too, my buddy. And yet to be revealed is Will Townsley. Yeah. My son-in-law, Rick, he's a dentist and a businessman. I'm so proud of him. He was in the first group that we baptized when Rick was in high school here. And Rick and Shannon got married, and Shannon's just been such a joy to our life. It's good that you have the compliant child first, because you'll have that second child, you know? And then Whitney, what a blessing she is to our life. We love Whitney, and she's... First time I remember seeing Whitney and her little sister Jordan were heading to Met Kids, Jesse. They were just little girls, heading to, and all of a sudden, you know, Bubba snagged that girl. Well, not then, but I mean, later on, Lord. And then Bubba, I'm so proud of him and all God's doing through his life. Encourage you guys to come back at 3. Half our band, for those of you that don't know, half our band tours with Miranda Lambert, so they're pretty good boys. So they're going to be these guys are going to be playing. I've heard them play the what you're going to hear when they play. They call themselves the 12-step blues band. So I'm not sure I know what that means. But I just call them Hayden's All Stars, right? And Lainey's going to be singing, and it's going to be awesome. You don't want to miss it. Go home, get your stuff, come back. We have the food trucks out there, stuff for the kids. Come and go. We've got plenty of time to see the Cowboys win, so don't worry about that. Let me pray over you, and again, thank you for being here. Father, thank you. Thank you for what you're doing in our church. And Lord, I thank you for the friends that have helped us. For the Father that has honored us, for the faith that has held us. And Father, we just simply say, this is about you. All glory and honor and praise is to you. Thank you, Lord, for the thousands of lives that have been touched and transformed. Thank you, Lord, for the people that you've sent into this ministry. Thank you, Father, for the core of people that poured into this. This ministry is fruit abounding to their account. And I pray, Lord, you'll bless us in the days ahead. We want to expand and extend the effectiveness of this outreach until you come again. So bless us, Lord. And if there's one in this room who's never trusted you, may this be the moment when they say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. Forgive my sin, be a reality in me. May they receive you. And for any in the room who needs someone just to love on them and pray for them before they leave, I pray they'll come forward and allow someone here at the front to pray for them, to pray over them, Lord. Thank you for the joy of knowing Jesus. Bless, Lord, as we prepare to leave. Bless the activities of the afternoon as we celebrate. In Christ's name.